Every 40 seconds, someone makes the tragic decision that life is no longer worth living. UN Secretary General Antonio Guterres made this known while delivering his message for World Mental Health Day, usually observed on October the 10th. According to him, suicide is the second leading cause of death among young people between age 15 and 29.
Every 40 seconds, someone makes the tragic decision that life is no longer worth living. Suicide is the second leading cause of death among young people aged 15 to 29. Mental health has been neglected for too long. It concerns us all, and greater action is urgent. We need stronger investments in services, and we must not allow stigma to push people away from the assistance they need. I'm speaking my mind because I care deeply. There is no health without mental health.
Well, it is estimated that about 800,000 persons die every year due to suicide-related cases. In the wake of 2019, Nigeria has witnessed several suicide cases, mostly linked to depression and lack of attention to mental health. Our investigative reporter, Mary Chinda, takes a look at one of the saddest suicide cases in the country, the case of a 21-year-old first-class student of the University of Nigeria, Nsukka.
1,000 persons die by suicide every year. Now, that's according to statistics from the World Health Organization. More statistics reveal that every 40 seconds, at least one person is likely to die by suicide. Suicide is the second leading cause of death among 15 to 29-year-olds globally. When Nigerians cross over to the new year in 2019, it was all prayers to God and excitement. Little did the nation anticipate the reign of multiple suicides that would soon ravage it. January 2, 2019 was greeted with the first case of suicide. DJXG, the popular Lagos DJ, who took his own life, allegedly over marital troubles, just a few hours after posting a sad suicide note on his Instagram account. Then to Ms. Hikmat Badamosi, a 100-level student of the University of Port Harcourt. And that statistics continued to swell with a first-class student of yet another Nigerian university, the 21-year-old Akachi Chukwuemeka, who took his own life after dropping a suicide note on his Facebook page. This suicide takes me all the way to the University of Nigeria, Nsukka, where his friends and classmates speak about his last moments.
Akachi was dealing with depression long before he came out as an atheist. So, if anything, the depression had left a footprint.
I meet Victor, Akachi's closest friend and course mate. He is very emotional as he speaks with me. He deeply regrets his friend's decision to commit suicide.
I never expected something like this to happen. It was a shock.
Only a few days after, another devastating news breaks about yet another suicide case. This time, a church worker, a music minister, allegedly from the Redeemed Christian Church of God, Michael Orowosaye in Abuja. Now, this leads me to the streets of Lagos, where I ask the question, why would someone want to take their life?
I just read recently of the jump bite who failed jump the second time and went to commit suicide, and that was crazy.
I think the guy that committed suicide has low self-esteem. Suicide is not the best way out. Have a purpose on this earth, so I can't waste it by committing suicide.
These answers lead me to a mega church where I ask this clergyman one question. What does religion say about suicide?
The spirits responsible for suicide are wicked spirits. We've got to understand that this physical world is controlled by the spiritual. Paul said, we don't wrestle with flesh and blood, but against principalities, powers, rulers, wicked spirits in high places.
And seeing that Islam is one of the two major religions in Nigeria, I am here at the Lekki Central Mosque in Lagos to ask the same question. Is there a spiritual side to suicide? And if there is, what is it?
As a Muslim cleric, I think suicide is demonic. It is against the law of God, against the law of Allah.
Religion has given us its side. Now, we speak to the experts. Dr. Maimona is a psychologist. She tells people to stop blaming suicide victims.
Sometimes when people just sit down, just make statements like those that have attempted suicide, those that have killed themselves, that they are worthless, they are sinners. No, you shouldn't say such a thing. We as a society, we should begin to build a culture of compassion where we show empathy to people, listen to people non-judgmentally, to understand them from their point of view rather than just to respond to them.
She says with love and support, along with professional help, depression and suicide can be overcome. Mary Chinda for Plus TV Africa.
And now with me in the studio is Mary Chinda. She joins me for more conversation. Good morning again, Mary.
Good morning. Good morning.
And great report there, I must
thank
say.
Thank you.
Now, Mary, you were in Nsukka. You traveled as far as Nsukka to find out more about Akachi. So could you tell us very quickly about the Akachi story again?
This is one very sad case. Looking at that report alone, I'm almost drawn to tears. How a young man, 21, first graduating with a first class, according to what the university told me, and all of a sudden he decides to end it all. It goes to tell us how much we bottle up inside. It goes to tell us how much sometimes we're not mentally, together. Our mental health is going down the drain and we don't pay attention to it. Many a time we just want to speak English language and forget about it. Many other times you want to talk to someone. You want to talk to your mom, you want to talk to your dad, you want to talk to your colleague or your boss at the office, and they say to you, you know what? Whatever you're saying, depression or whatever you're saying, is a white man's illness. I mean, what should you be talking about this? Or sometimes people think it's maybe the witches from your village. Oh, yeah, there is a spiritual side to depression and all of that. But the truth is, this is a very sad case where a young man who I think would have emerged the next Wole Soyinka or Chinua Achebe of Nigeria and Africa, decides to end it all.
Mm-hmm. So what's, in your opinion, the cause of this increase in suicide cases that we see, especially in Nigeria, but among young people?
First, I would say, just like the Secretary General of UN has said, there is no health without mental health. First, we have, over the years, not giving attention to our mental health. We have, over the years, tried to, just ignore this part of it. And that's why in 2019 alone, we've seen over 20 cases of suicide. The first one being DJ XG on January 2nd. Then we begin to see how almost every month somebody is committing attempting suicide. Almost every month, many of them are very successful. We see the young girl in Port Harcourt who took her life because her boyfriend jilted her. We see this case of Akachi. We've seen several other cases. We saw the case of the RCCG church worker, the alleged RCCG church worker, and all of those things. People are not paying attention to your mental health. Look, as you live in life, things are going to be tough. People are going to throw things at you, but you need to talk about it. You need to find someone you talk about. You need to meet a psychologist. You need to talk to someone. You need to be able to find your own way of venting. Again, another thing that leads to this suicide. Suicide isn't something that you just wake up and decide to commit or decide to end it all. No, they are bottled up feelings. Many a time, in the course of all of this, I had to even meet a psychologist. And there's this therapy about that takes you back to your past. It's called the little child approach. It takes you back to your past. It talks about It helps you vent the pain of your past. For many of us are carrying things, you know, inside. So we're carrying pain, we're carrying, you know, unforgiveness. So when somebody else tries to trigger off that part of us that we've not dealt with, it's a chain reaction. But the person doesn't understand. The person who's triggering you doesn't understand. Now, pastors, your reverend fathers in church, leaders, politicians, all of these people suffer from depression. The fact that you're a pastor does not mean that you can't, you know, come down with depression at all. So we need to start identifying the fact that depression is real. Depression is not a white man's illness. Depression is here. As long as you're human, you are likely to battle depression. So what do you do when you're depressed?
So that takes takes me to my final question for you, Mary. And it's great that we're having this conversation today, because today is a World Mental Health Day. And interestingly, the topic again, it's preventing suicide.
Yes.
Now, that's why I said it brings me to my last question, which you're already talking about. How do you think we can prevent this? You know, society at large, you've talked about compassion and, you know, some understand, but how do we prevent it moving forward, especially in our own society?
Okay, first, I would just quickly give you, in the course of this documentary, I had to do some research. I talked to a psychologist, Dr. Osaz, and what it is what I recommend, the ALGEE method. ALGEE method, A-L-G-E-E. Now, pay attention. Awareness. Be aware. Be aware of depression for your own self. Then your parents, your father, your mother, your colleague at the office, be aware. Be aware of it. Another thing is L, listen, listen. Open your ears. Shut your mouth. Just listen. Listen to the person who is talking to you. Don't try to judge. Listen non-judgmentally. Again, give support. Give support. Give support.
In
that's
some,
the point.
In what way?
Give support by getting the person to, you know, talk to a psychologist, getting the person to talk to for a lot of us who are Christians, you know, I mean, Nigerians are Christians, talk to a pastor, talk to, you know, just talk to someone. Talk to someone who's not going to judge you. Again, it's encouragement.
But an expert.
Yes, encouragement. Another thing is ensure that the help and the support that you're providing, the person who is depressed sees a psychologist, goes through all of the processes. And I must quickly add, Amaka, in Nigeria, we're very religious people. So we're either Christians or we're Muslims. Now, this documentary
Other religious persuasions.
Okay, yes. So this documentary is a call to action that as Christians, pastors and imams, we must rise up to not just, you know, I'm preaching about it. Churches and mosques must be able to come down with mental health centers, talking about mental health first aid. While you're giving spiritual support, while of course we take everything to the Lord in prayer, let churches and mosques have counseling rooms where they first know, the pastor or the imam first knows what to do when you're talking to someone who's depressed, for instance. Don't judge. Mm-hmm. Don't judge. Don't say, oh, you're a pastor. You're a man of God. You shouldn't be depressed. No. Listen. Pastors, according to statistics, have committed suicide over the last, you know, few months and years
than anyone else. Thank you so very much, Mary. We would love to continue this, but in the interest of time, we'll have to move on. Thanks for your intervention,
especially for the ALGEE method. Yeah. Thank you.
All right. So moving on, Nigerian entertainers are strong influencers among the youth in Nigeria and across the globe. With this leverage, some experts feel entertainers can help promote mental health and well-being by sharing powerful stories.
I'll start with the entertainment industry and the challenges that I'm sure that everyone faces, including myself, is understanding who you are. We live in a world where everybody's trying to be a clone of somebody else, and that is beyond Nigeria. That's a worldwide issue. And so I think one of the things that we need to start doing in Nigeria is just normalizing your life. And then in the same space, you know, some weeks ago I put up a question. I said, are you a safe space? Can someone actually walk up to you as an entertainer and say, I'm going through this, and then you're going to listen and, like, help? Just maybe just by listening, or even give advice and say, maybe see this person, or, you know, or come and see me. One of the things that I do is that I counsel for free. I don't put it on social media. I don't put my number out there. But there's so many people who come and see me and say, this is what's going on. And it's not that I'm not doing it to make myself feel good about myself. I'm doing it because I realize that there are times I wish I had someone to talk to and there was no one. And one of the things my husband has always taught me is be the change that you expect to see in other people. And that's my challenge to myself.